Well, hi there, folks. This is your host, IDGS. Welcome back to PC Replay Baseball here for 2016 Baltimore Orioles. So we're going to be playing another game today, but before we do that, just wanted to go over a few things here. Thanks to some comments in our channel there, we were able to find our game guides. And so I think there's a lot of people that might be like myself and kind of newer to the system or not 100% sure how everything operates. So as we go through things, I'm going to be pulling up some of these charts and stuff just so we can analyze and see things. Here's my number one problem I have with the game so far. Is if we just take a look at, say, Chris Archer, since he happens to be on here. So there's a lot of stats and a lot of statistics here, and that's pretty cool. I like that. More stats is better. Gives you more things to look at, you know, range and hold and all that. The problem I have is, and this is confusing, is sometimes you want a really low stat, and sometimes you want a really high stat. It's not well formatted in the game as, oh, a two. Hey, is it too good there or is it too bad? Because normally the stats are from like 0 to 6 or 1 to 5 or something. And maybe they roll on a 6-sided dice to compare it against your stat. So if we look at, say, for example, let me bring this over here and show you what I'm talking about. So here's just from their intro and rules section here. Here is a how to scout a player in Replay Baseball, and kind of gives you an example card here. So you can see here over on this side here under defense, the fielding rating. So large number is overall fielding rating from 1 to 5. 1 is the very best. And then the raised number, the raised number here is going to be is error rating with 0, low number, to high number, 66, with 66 being the best. So you have two numbers here that are exactly the opposite. Here you want a really low number, so from 1 to 5. And here you want a really high number because you want to have, you know, a better error rating. Thank you. Couldn't think of it. Okay, then you look at this here. You got a hold rating, which is 1, you think, oh, is that really good or really bad? Well, you got to look. Ability to hold runners on base and prevent stealing. 5 is the best. 1 is the worst. So, again, is this low number good or bad? So, I guess it's the biggest confusion. Not only that, but let's scroll back up to the beginning here and take a look at batters here. Okay, so where was it I was reading this information here so I can show you here? Let's see. Hang on, it's going to take me a second to find it. Maybe it was the next section. No, it was this section. All right. Maybe it was up here. I'm trying to remember where it was. I'll find it. I promise you I will find it. Okay, so here's I didn't even see this one, but here's another example of what I'm talking about. So batters are also rated by their bunting ability, with 1 rating representing the most successful bunters, 3 being average, and 5 reflecting a player who virtually never lays down a bunt. So you have a low number in bunting is good, while a high number in everything else seems to be good. Okay, so the large number here next to the batter's name represents his speed and base running ability. A rating of 5 is best. 1 is the slowest. What I'm actually was looking for, though, is, maybe it was in here. So I guess what I'm trying to say is, it's going to take a little while to understand and learn the game, because some of the statistics you want really low numbers, which are better than high numbers, and then you have other numbers where the high number is better than being the low number. So it's just going to take a little while to get used to and figure out what's good to have, a low number or high number in certain categories. What I was actually looking for, let's see if I can find it again here, because here it is right here, fielders. So this is a perfect example of what I'm talking about. So fielding rating here are expressed in a 1 to 5 scale. Infielders have an overall fielding rating to cover range, position, and double play skills. So the infielders have one rating, which is going to cover their range, their positioning, and their ability to play doubles, to make double plays. A rating of 1 is gold glove material. So infielders, you want to have really low stats. All right, outfielders have 2 ratings. The first rating represents their range and positioning skills. Second, in parentheses, indicates their arm accuracy and strength, and the ability to prevent extra base advancements. A player with a 5 in both gold is a player in 5 in both categories is gold glove material. So you have outfielders that you want really high stats with, and your infielders you want really low stats with. And it's just, I don't know why they didn't just go with, you know, high is better in every category or low is better in every category. Just, it's crazy that they would not be able to figure that out. And you know, especially here, you got infielders you want low, outfielders you want high, bunting statistics you want low, speed rating you want high. I'm not saying it's being confusing, all right, but it's just been a lot harder to understand and look at a player with all these numbers and stats and go, oh yeah, he's really good, or oh no, this guy sucks. Because it's got to be like, okay, well, wait a minute. Wild pitch. Did I want really low or did I want really high defense? Did I want really low or really high in that? So, anyways, hopefully you understand part of my frustrations with it. It just seems like it's a little bit harder than it needs to be because of the tendencies for some numbers to be really... good, you mean you need a low number, and for other stats and abilities you want really high. So here, if we just look, we'll just take this, we'll go through really quickly here a sample pitcher and a sample batter, and just so we can kind of understand. So again, this is our fielding rating over here. Low is better, so defensive ability low here, and then this is our error rating. This is their ability to hold runners. Higher is better. This is their wild pitch rating. So higher is better. Then this column here is going to be your pitcher's endurance. So it'll tell you either S or R. S is a starter. R is a reliever. And it'll tell you how many innings until the pitcher gets tired. And we'll go to his B rating. And then there's this number here for pitcher's endurance factor for starting and or relieving. Starters are rated for endurance two ways, either innings or batter's face. So, yeah, you can use this top one or you can use this bottom one. This is a batter's face. So after 25 batters, then he'll go into his B rating. But there are some exceptions to that as well. This is his stat line here. Here's his offensive rating over here. He bats left. First letter is going to be whether he bats left or right. Second number is going to be the card he uses. So in this case, he's going to use card number 1. 1 is the poorest hitter, 6 being the best. And the little 3 there represents his bunting ability, with one being the best bunter and three being the worst, or five being the worst. So he's a really bad hitter and an average bunter. Then second set of numbers and letters is his base running ability. So steal, letter, and jump rating, same as non-pitchers. All right, so this is going to be his base running ability there. All right, so then if we actually look at the cards, I'll look at the cards here after we look at a player. So here is a sample batter. So it tells you what side of the plate he bats from. Each batter is based on base running from 1 to 5, 5 being the best. So 1 to 5, 5 being the best. Base stealing success from A to L. So A is the best, so pretty good stealer. He's a B stealer. And getting a jump to steal is the raised number, 1 to 6, and 6 steals the most often. So this guy doesn't steal much, but he's very fast and able to steal a base when he tries, I guess is the best way to put that. All right, so games played at each defensive position. So this would be 92 games he played in left field. Then his fielding rating. So this is going to be, again, first number is going to be his outfield fielding rating. Okay, so the first one was his fielding rating, and the second one in the brackets is overall fielding rating, first number, outfielders have an arm rating or catcher. Okay, so this is his arm rating. So this is more like his first number is like his range, ability to catch the ball. The second number in the brackets is his ability to his throwing ability, keeping players on base, throwing runners out, et cetera, et cetera. And then, of course, this is his error rating there. This is all good information, hopefully. This is his bunt number, 1 to 5, and 1 is the best, so lower is better here. I almost wish they would have color-coded these numbers or something to give you a hint as to whether they're really good at something or really bad at something. You know, like, you know, if 1 to 5 is the best, then, like, 1, you could color code them as, like, blue, 2 could be green or something to show that, okay, 1, he's really, really good. 2, he's, you know, better than average. Then average, they could have just left the normal color code. And then 4 and 5, 4, you know, make a yellow, and red could be, or 5 could be like a red or something. Color code it or underline it or something to kind of make it stand out, I guess, a little bit. Make it easier to learn. So that's the fielder, the batter, and the pitcher. Kind of, and we'll be referring to this quite a bit. This video is probably going to go really, really long. I apologize for that in advance, because of all the information. So, when we look at the actual cards here, so we know we roll a die, and that's going to represent which column is going to be used in both the batter and the pitcher card. So column 1, if we look at column 1, it's going to, let's look at pitchers first. Let's go up here. So pitchers are graded from 1 to 5. 1 is really, really good. Okay, so column 1 for pitchers, so 1 and 2, reflect the pitcher's ability to strike out batters. A pitcher with an average grades of 1 in both columns is capable of fanning almost a man an inning. So lots of 1s in column 1 and 2 is strikeouts. So you can see here, strikes out, strikes out, strikes out. A pitcher with 5s in all the columns, not very good. He's going to give up lots of hits, et cetera, et cetera. So the more lower numbers here in column 1 and 2, more strikeouts. Column number 3 reflects a pitcher's ability to keep hit totals low. 1 is best, is again, pitchers who allow very few hits So 111, then 233. So, if I was to get a 111 here in column three, probably not going to be a hit. Two might be a hit, depending on what the batter's card is, and three might be hits. So, obviously, lower number there in column three. Column four special. So, pitchers are not rated in column four because this column represents infield defense. So, you're going to have first base, second base, third base, shortstop, second base. So, first base, second, third, short, second. I don't know why they didn't go first base, second, short, third, whatever. I don't know. It's just a random D6. But, anyways, so that's going to check the infielder's defense, column four on the pitcher card. Column five measures a pitcher's control. So a pitcher with an average column grade five of one will keep many runners off the base paths. So again, ones, really low numbers are good. A pitcher averaging fours and fives, bad. So more ones, or twos, the higher the number, not going to be as good. The little uppercase number there, the two and the one there in that case. Pitchers with raised numbers beside their ones in column five allow even fewer walks, while pitchers with W symbols on their card are excessively wild. So what ends up happening is sometimes they'll roll a die and compare it, and it'll take hits away, I believe, based on what those numbers are. So pitchers with raised numbers beside one in column five allow even fewer walks. So better control. So in this case, if he rolls a walk, I think it rolls a die to see if it checks the raised number to see if he really walks them or not. Column six is a golfer ball column. A pitcher with an average column six grade of one will allow very few home runs, while pitchers with fives will face a thread along ball on every pitch. Pitchers with raised number beside their ones in column six even allow fewer home runs. So again, he might give up a home run, but then they have to check and make sure, was it really a home run? So, obviously ones are good. So if you see a pitcher card with lots of ones in there, that's going to be really, really tough to get hits and lots of strikeouts and not many walks. So the more twos and threes and fours and fives you see, the better off it's going to be for the batter. Well, so that's kind of an overview of the pitcher matrix there. If we look at the batter matrix, so in column one here, especially resolve for hits with error possibilities, clutch hits, stolen bases, or base on balls for walks for batters who walk a lot. So that's what those are going to be. On the negative side are strikeouts and double plays as well. So depending on if the hitter was really, had good clutch hitting, or if he struck out a lot, or hit into double plays a lot. So column one. Column two offers a solid single as well as possible base hits that can be cut off with good outfield play. So lots of singles and good defensive stops. There's strikeouts, ground outs, and sacrificed flies as well. But the most dreaded number from the hitter's point of view is in his game misses numbers at 2-1. But the most dreaded number from a hitter's point of view is his game miss number at 2-1. So his game miss number, that must be 2-1. If a player missed a lot of action, his rating could be severe. So, okay, so this spot, 2-1, if a player missed a lot of games from injury or whatever, he's going to have a worse stat box in this spot as opposed to some of the other players that played more games. Players with an L or R besides their game miss number can avoid missing games if they're platooned properly. Okay. Column three. So column three here, one of the most major interactive columns with the pitcher. Most numbers in this column are potential singles or doubles or triples, but a good pitcher can prevent many possibilities. So based on their ones, if they have lots of ones, as opposed to twos and threes and fours. If the pitcher cannot prevent the hit, base runners often have the opportunity for extra bases against the defensive outfield. A dice number of 3-6, so this spot here, is the lefty-righty hit possibility. There is frequently a possible infield hit or rare play at 3-4. So at 3-4, an infield hit or a rare play sometimes. So we'll have to look for some of these special things to come up. All right, column 4, the fielding ability of the defense infield comes into play. A good fielder can cut off a single or turn a double play when a mediocre fielder cannot. Some skilled batters have a strategy hit, which could be a bunt single with the infielder playing back, or a double past the infielder's ear if he's playing in, but good infielders can prevent both. All right, so that's column 4, kind of a matchup between how the batter, his kind of batting skill versus the infield skill of first base, second base, third base, short, and that. So that's column 4. That'll be an interesting matchup. Column 5 takes walks and hits by pitches and the occasional base hit. So lots of walks, a hit by pitch, or occasionally a hit here and there. Column can also produce wild pitches, pass balls, and pickoffs. So wild pitches, pass balls, and pickoffs. An excellent control pitcher can convert many possible walks into ground outs. So again, if the pitcher control card might change walks into ground outs, or ground outs into, instead of walks into ground outs. You also find a few strikeouts and sacrifice flies here in column 5. Column 6 is the power column. Usually the batter results at 6-6 is his strongest chance at a home run, with sluggers also having home runs and other base hit chances at 6-2 and 6-4 and other dice numbers. Some basic hits can challenge outfielders and wind up as doubles, triples, and even inside the park home runs. Many hitters with more extreme real-life lefty-righty splits can also have split numbers in this column. With one result, it can be used with the lefty pitcher on the mound, the other against a righty. Column 6 also has sacrifice flies, routine fly balls, and some strikeouts. All right, each batter also has a separate line in his car for the hit and run play. So there's a hit and run play. Generally, it's best to look for a hitter who doesn't strike out much and either has a 12 or 13 in his hit and run column, so he does have one there. A 33 or 34 in that row also indicates that the batter can hit and run effectively. So there's a 34, so a 13 and a 34. Batters can also be rated for their bunting ability, with the 1 rating representing the most successful, 3 average, 5 reflect a player who's virtually never lays down a bunt. So pretty good bunter here in this case. All right, so much more, and this document has been pretty helpful. Again, it's been very helpful to read through and just kind of familiarize yourself with things. And, you know, they give some good examples here on the difference here. So the first example here are Jim Palmer and Rod Carew, and the dice roll was a 6, so we're in column 6, and the white dice was a 2, and the blue dice for the pitcher was a 3. So the pitcher was a 6-3, so that's a 1, so obviously good low number for the pitcher. And the batter was a 6-2, which is an 8 with a star, so it's going to end up being a 9 star. So if we look at 9, and 9 on the 6 column is a single to center field. So, it's pretty easy to figure all that out. So, this document has been very, very helpful. This one here is kind of the matrix, example of what's going on for each of the different columns based upon the dice numbers and all that. So if you roll column one, if you get a 2-6, it's a strikeout and all the runners are going to hold. If you roll a 7, it's going to be a pop up to second base and runners are going to hold, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So we're going to use this a couple times when we're doing replays here to kind of, you know, gauge what had happened through the matrix of the game as we play it out. So we are in Friday. No, we're in Saturday, April 9th here. We got a 2-2 record for Baltimore, which is, if I actually go to roster, was it statistics? Yes, yeah, statistics. So I just happened to just glance through here and look. You can see our batting averages for our team are not very good. Manny Machado and Pedro Alvarez are the only ones doing anything. Actually, Nolan Reimold is doing a pretty good job there, 286. But everybody else, 250, 200, 154, 0. Matt Wieters is actually 10 at-bats. He's got 5 hits. So, yeah, he's doing pretty good, too, Matt Wieters. What do we have here? Adam Jones, 222. J.J. Hardy, 198. Chris Tillman, not a hit. Tyler Wilson, not a hit. McFarland, not a hit. Givens, not a hit. Young-So Kim, not a hit. Now, some of these guys haven't played any games yet, but still, our offense has gotten nowhere, and we're 2-2, so our pitching has basically been saving us these first couple games. We had, if we look at our Baltimore here, if we go to our schedule here, so we had a 1-3 game, which we lost. I mean, we only gave up 3 runs, not bad pitching. We won a 3-0 game, great pitching there. We won a 5-2 game, pretty reasonable, and then we lost a 3-4 game. So in 4 games, we've given up 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 runs total in 4 games. That is pretty good for the American League. We just haven't got our offense off track yet. So we're going to play in game number 2 against Tampa, and then we got 3 against Boston and 3 against Texas. So we'll keep our eye on Boston and Texas for the next couple games, just to keep our eye on what they're doing. If you look at our standings here, Boston is 1-2, so they've only played 3 games, and Texas is 3-2, tied for their division lead. So you can see here from Today in Baseball, the main page here, Chris Archer struck out 12 hitters, so he was a beast. Well, not much we could do about that. And had a really good game against us. We almost beat them, 4-3. Couldn't get a run. Although that double Machado, the third base coach should have waved him in. I was yelling and screaming for him to wave him in, but he didn't do it. Anyways, here we go. On to Saturday, April 9th. And we're going to game simulcast here. Quite a few games on the schedule. We are going to play, Baltimore, where are you? Chicago, Detroit, are we not on the schedule today? Hang on. Let me just make sure, because I don't want to play the day if we're not scheduled. Oh, yeah, we're not until Sunday, so we have a couple-day break, actually. That's weird. So we played Friday, and then we don't play again until Sunday, and then we play Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, so 4 days in a row. We got a couple days off here before we face Tampa Bay. All right, so interesting. So we are going to auto-play the day Saturday, since we don't play. Did Tampa Bay play? Did they play? No, I was going to say. They should not have played a game. Okay. So Tampa Bay 4-1. Baltimore 2-2. Boston improves to 2-2, so they got a big win. Let's check out the box scores here. Boston beats Toronto 15-3. I like the ability you can just go in and check out what happened in their game, like the Yankees in Detroit here, or Minnesota and Kansas City 6-5 and 12. Well, let's find out what happened in the 12th inning there. So, Brian Dozier hit a home run in the top of the 12th. And then Escobar doubled to lead off the inning. Then he had a strikeout, a ground out to first unassisted, and then another strikeout. Great. One other thing before we get into the game, actually. If we go to options here, I do want to show you guys, I actually changed a few of my options here. Nothing crazy. It was actually season display options. So under display options, just for us to make it a little easier, I've checked this box here, highlight card results in yellow. So it'll show us the boxes that we roll on the cards in yellow. I think that'll help a little bit. And then there was one other option that was nothing too dramatic. What was it? Another little setting somewhere that I adjusted. Maybe one here. I did switch open season to the team screen Baltimore, so just default. I mean, that's just for me instead of... Yeah, you know, when I open the game, it'll just go to Baltimore as opposed to just going to the main screen. There was... Oh, play results, use fielding number position. So I checked this box as well. So it should give us 4-6-3 as opposed to, you know, shortstop, left, you know, shortstop to pitcher or whatever for the out. So it should give us the numbers. And that's for you guys. So... Anyways, now we are on to Sunday. Let's go ahead and game simulcast. Baltimore, Tampa Bay, Baltimore. There we go. All right, so pitching today, matchup is going to be Jake or Odorizzi for Tampa Bay and Vance Worley for Baltimore. Jake is pitched... A game so far as a 1.5 ERA, won his game. And this is Vance's first game. We got Rickard, Machado, Davis, Trumbo, Weeters, Alvarez, Hardy, Shope, and Young So Kim as our players today. We'll have the AI play Tampa Bay, obviously. And we'll play ball. I know it's been 33 minutes already. So the question is, do I start another video before we actually start, or I just continue this? I think I'm just going to go ahead and just make this just a big, long video. All right, so here we are. So actually, Vance Worley, really, he's 1-0. Remember, we talked about having ones and twos and, ones, a lot of ones, a lot of twos, a lot of threes. Well... Vance Worley, he's got a lot of threes and fours and fives. He's got a few ones there. So we might get our offense kicking today. Oh, no, wait, this is our pitcher. Whoa, Vance, what in the hell are you doing? He's got a good defense. Remember, lower is better there. He doesn't make many errors. Wild pitch. Was that a, do we need a high or low on that? I can't remember. Vance, it's going to be a challenge to get some outs here with Vance Worley on the hill today. Jeez. Yep, 13 right up the middle. So, just to show you the difference, if we go back to our little thing here. All right, so, you know, let's say he had a 1 there. Logan Forsythe had a 10. That would be 10 plus 1 is 11 on column 1. So, I guess 11 to 15 is going to be a single up the middle. It wouldn't have mattered in this case. He's going to get a hit one way or the other. So, disregard. We'll move on.
No outs, man on first.
Logan Morrison. So this is the power, Colin. And this time he pops it up to second. So 31 plus 2 is going to be a 33 in column 6. Let me just check that column. 30, what was it? 33. So 32, 33, 34, 35, 36 are all going to be pop-ups or short flyouts.
One out, man on first.
I do like the yellow highlighting there. One out, man on first. The power column again is an 18 deep fly to left field. And I'm probably going to be, kind of going a little bit slow here because I'm going to be looking at, and I don't think, do you guys really want me dragging this over after every pitch to look at it? Probably not. I'm only going to do that when, interesting things pop in, so we can learn it together. But I mean, since I had it over there, I guess I could have just left it. So, what was it? 18 there. So, is that what he got? 16, yeah, 18. So 18 was 17. 18 is a deep fly out to left field, sacrifice fly. Any runner scores from third with less than two outs. So, all right. And what I might do is just read off what the actually says on the sheet as we do
Two
a few
outs,
of
men
these
on
plays.
first.
All right, come on, Vance, you can do this. That's a one and a four on column five is going to be a strikeout. I'm sorry, not column
No
five. That'll be
runs,
column
one
two.
hit, and one left on.
Column two. Column two. There's column two. And he rolled. What did he roll? A five. Yeah, so two through six is a strikeout. Same as column one. So a one plus a five is still going to be a six. A one. So if he rolls a three or four, it's going to be a strikeout for sure. If he rolls a five, that's where we're going to run into problems, because we could have a five. That would be a 10. That would be a fly out. So two, column two is actually good for us against Corey Dickerson.
Bottom of the
Anyways,
first.
that's the bottom of the first. Minnesota takes a 2-0 lead in the top of the first. All right, Joey Rickard here, who has got 14 at bats, three strikeouts, and not a hit to be shown anywhere. So he's got a 55 and a 2 is a 56. Then it's got a little raised 4. So that one looks a little interesting. So let's take a look at that one. So that's going to be column 2. All right, so that ended up being a 57. All right, so if you look at this, 57 is a looping drive into the outfield. So the blue die is actually going to represent which outfielder it went to. If the outfielder's defensive rating is higher than the raised number besides the 55 on the batter card, so you see this little raised number is a 4. If their defense is higher than that, he has made a fine running catch for a fly out. So this is a 4, and we hit it to Kielmeyer, whose defense is a 5. Okay. A little unsure of why that wasn't just a. If the outfielder's defense rating is higher than the raised number, besides that, he made a fine running catch for fly out runners on second and third advance. If the outfielder's defensive rating is not higher than the raised number, the ball falls in for a single. Runners advance one base, two base hit their speed is higher than the outfielder's arm. Am I in column two? I am in column two. This was a column two, 57 in column two. Home to 57. I don't know what I'm missing here. So it looks to me like maybe we're playing with. Well, it ended up being ballpark effect. Maybe. Oh, because this has got. colors. Well, we haven't talked about that. There's colored on some of the cards, and they represent. So the colored ones must mean ballpark effect comes into play. So we need a 61 or higher. Not this time. It's going to be a fly ball to center field.
One out. Base is empty.
All right. I'm going to try and go a little bit faster, not use up all our time. 30 is a fly out to center field.
Two outs. Base is empty.
All right. Two outs. Base is empty. Chris Davis batting 200. 3 of 15. Six is going to be a strikeout. So pretty much 2-6. It's going to be a strikeout and come 1-2.
And just like that, the inning's over. Top of the second.
All right. Steve Pierce has come up. One hit at four bats. 6-6-6. That can't be good. And Pierce takes Worley deep, gone, and see you later, alligator. So, since that was interesting, let's bring that up in column one here for you guys. That ended up being, column six of 14. Yes, of course it was. Yes, go out of the way, you stupid thing. Column 6 of 14. So, yeah, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16 just tells you where it got hit. So, column 6 is dangerous. We don't want to roll lots of red 6s.
No outs. Base is empty.
It's a 3. 57 plus 1 is 58. Rare play possibility, and it's not a rare play. Dribble to the mound. Pitcher tries to retire the batter. Roll a die against the batter's speed. Die is higher. He is out. So again, yeah. It's hard to know. Do I want a low number there
one
or
out,
high
base
number?
Base is empty.
All right. One out. Base is empty. Two. Let's see. 11 plus and a 4. That's going to be a single to right field.
One out. Man on first.
Hope he's going to try a steal attempt or try to get his hold rating as a 46. And the dice are not higher runner. He's caught stealing. Yeah.
Two outs. Base is empty.
Caught him. Gunned him down. Matt Wieters threw him out. Oh, column six again. Pop up to second base.
One run, two hits, and none left on. Bottom of the second.
All right, well, we got a lot of big poppers on our team. So when it's our turn, we do want to see lots of sixes. So Jake Odorizzi, he's got a few ones, some twos, a couple threes and fours. So he's not all ones and twos, which is good. So we might stand a chance of getting a few hits. Not quite as bad as Worley is for our team, but all right, Trumbo, we would like a 6 column, please. That's a 5. 45, 47, fly out to center.
One out, base is empty.
All right, Matt Wieters. That's going to be 4, and this ball hit to short.
Two outs, base is empty.
Alvarez, 32.
It's a 1-2-3 inning. Top of the third.
All right, 1-0 Tampa. Worley pitching 24 base on balls.
No outs, man on first.
Uh-oh, base action. 66 is a hold rating. 4. Picked off. Picked off, baby. Wow. So we've thrown out a stealer, and we picked a guy off at first.
One out. Base is empty.
Or was he safe? No, he was out. Okay, good. Logan Forsythe, who had a single. 31 is liner to Kim on the left.
Two outs. Base is empty.
Morris in here pop up to second base.
No runs, no hits, and none left on. Bottom of the third.
All right, J.J. Hardy here. Two hits, 11 at-bats. Batting 192. 36, ground ball to third. Longoria here. It's a 5-3 play.
One out, base is empty.
Shope and Ordozoni. Shope, two hits, 13 at-bats, 154 average. That's a 2. That's hit to Logan as well. Or Evan, I'm sorry, Evan. It's going to be a 5-3.
Two outs, base is empty.
And this is his first at-bat, so we'll give him a break. And all three plays went to Logan.
It's 1-2-3 innings.
I keep wanting to call him Logan, but it's Longoria at third.
Top of the fourth.
We've got nothing to show for all our efforts today. 10, that's a single in the center field. Great.
No outs, man.
They got
on
a
first.
6. Why don't we ever get a damn 6? 31 is fly out to center.
One out, man on first.
Another 6. Pop out, though.
Two outs, man on first.
He's got 30 home runs. We don't want a 6 column this time. 7. That's going to be a whole hit to Shope.
No runs, one hit, and one left on. Bottom of the fourth.
All right, Joey Rickard, fly out. Instead of saying F, CF, or this is what I changed in the options, so to just say 8. So center field. 37 is ground ball to second.
One out, base is empty.
Come on, guys. We got to get something going here. Let's go. 18, that's going to be a fly out to left field.
Two outs, base is empty.
So far, we got no hits. Looping drive into the left field. Outfielder races to make the catch. We're going to use the ballpark effect here. We need something high. It's not high. So it's a fly out to left field.
And just like that, the inning's over. Top of the fifth.
Souza with the single. Single to right field.
No outs, man on first.
All right, picked off. 4. Ground ball to short. Halfway in, force it second.
One out, man on first.
Halfway. Halfway in. He's going to try to steal here, is he? We already threw out one guy. Runner holds, okay.
One out, man on first.
Halfway is where you want him for double plays from what I read in the... If you have him halfway, you'll get more double plays, but you'll allow a few extra hits. 10. It's a single or a home run. Are you kidding me? Okay, it's just a single.
One out. Men on first and second.
Okay, so how do I get them back into normal position? Back. I guess I can't play back with this 8. Face some. Oh my gosh.
One out. Base is loaded.
Come on, Worley. Do we want to play in? Let's play in. We'll allow a few more extra hits, but we might be able to gun that runner down. 6 and gone 1 is a strikeout.
2 out, base is loaded.
All right, now we can just play back. All right, yeah, that's why it auto switches it when you have runners on and get the double play. It switches it over, which is good. All right, so now everyone's back. 2 outs, please get them out. That's 8-7. 2 base on balls.
2 outs, base is loaded.
Come on. 2-2 count. 31, line out to center. Wow, good.
No runs, 2 hits, and 3 left on.
All right, well, let's see. Is Boston playing today? They are. They're up 6-0 against Toronto. So that'll be our next opponent coming up. St. Louis is beating Atlanta 2-1. Pittsburgh is beating Cincinnati 3-1. All right, let's get our offense going here, please. Mark Trumbo, 3 hits. Only batting 231. That's 9 base on balls. Okay.
No outs, man on first.
Matt Wieters. So you see they automatically switch to halfway. That's what that. So the computer went to halfway because they're going to be trying for that double play. He's only got a 2 bunt. Seven is base on balls. All right.
No outs. Men on first and second.
All right. Pedro Alvarez, batting 308. Let's get a nice column 6-6, 355. That's going to be a 33. Liner to center field. Nobody can advance, huh? 34 to 37 would have been a double. So we were one short. We needed one more point. We needed that to be a 4, or we needed him to have a 31 on his card.
One out. Men on first and second.
All right, J.J. Hardy, 2 hits. 3 RBIs in these 2 hits. Come on now. 31 is going to be a fly out. We needed a 32 plus a 2 would have been 34. That would have been a double. So.
2 outs, men on first and second.
We've just been unlucky getting these. So, you know, if it comes to this column again, 31. There's his 31. And we need any number. So a 3-1 would be good for us because any one of those. No, wait. We need 34. So we need a 5 or 6 here to get a double. And that's going to be a strikeout. Oh, my gosh. Oh, my gosh.
No runs, no hits, and 2 left on.
Of course. We still have a no-hitter against us. Just, you know. Worley. 13s are going to be lined out to Hardy. And it's going to be
one out, base is empty.
L6. And it's a 12 hit by pitch.
One out, man on first.
Yeah, they all went to halfway, so try for the double play. Give us a double play ball. That's a 3 comp. That's 19. Infield single plus an error. Oh, Jesus. J.J. Hardy, 61. It's not higher, so no error.
One out, men on first and second.
All Souza with a single and a single so far today. That's a six. He struck out, so he went to his B grade
already. Two outs, men on first and second.
So why did he go to his B grade? We're only in the sixth inning. What's his R7? Well, it didn't matter because we're going to be taking him out anyways. We're going to be taking him out anyways once I figure out who we're going to take him out for. Let's take a look at who played in this game. There we are. It would have been Baltimore. No. Go back. God damn it. Schedule. All right. So this is game Sunday, April 10th, against Tampa Bay. So Vance Worley started. Brad Brick came in. All right. Well, oops. Nope. This guy's sub. All right. So lots of more ones. That's cool. I like that. But he only pitched for a few innings, but that's okay. 6-1 is going to be a strikeout to end the inning. There we go.
No
Brad
runs,
Brock
one
comes
hit,
in
and two
against
left
the lefty, Kilmeyer. Great defensive managerial play by Buck Showalter there.
Bottom of the sixth.
A.K.A. me. All right, so he's only had two at-bats. I think we pinch hit with him a couple times. He's hitless on the season. Now he's actually in the game. Let's see if he can do something here. That's going to be a 22. Single off the fielder's glove. Excellent.
No outs, men on first. The defense is playing in at the corners.
So they think we're going to bunt here with a one bunter. Well, I need to check our rules again because I don't remember. I think bunting, you need to be high bunter, right? Isn't bunting high? Where was it? Raise number is the bunting average, 1 to 5, with 1 being the best bunter. Oh, okay. So bunting you want low. Okay, good to know. Bunting you want low. How low do you go? Joey Rickard, who's got no hits on the season, we are going to sacrifice.
He's going to lay down a bunt.
Foul.
No outs, men on first. The defense is playing in at the corners.
We are going to risk it and sacrifice again.
He's going to lay down a bunt.
Ah, figures. So we had a force out at second.
One out, man on first.
Fielder's choice there. All right, Machado. Manny Machado. We got a 14 ball hit to short. Possible error, roll against the error rating. Ooh, 44. He makes a lot of errors. Come on. No, come on. He's out.
Two outs, men on first.
We do have a hit, though, so we will not be no hit. Chris Davis, my MVP so far. He's got a couple home runs, a couple big home runs. Oh, 66. Oh, Chris Davis knocks it out again. Oh, baby. Can you believe that? Can you believe it? We take the lead 2-1, just like that.
Two outs, base is empty.
Wow, he's got three on the season now. Good job. Wish the rest of his team might follow his lead and do something. Come on, Trumbo. We need a jumbo from Trumbo. 61. Towards the gap. Outfielder races to make the catch. We're going to roll some dice here. We need a high number. That's not high enough. And Kilmeyer makes the play.
Two runs, two hits, and none left on.
Boo.
Top of the seventh.
All right. So, yeah, we want low numbers here. So 2-2-2-1 is good. And then we want high numbers here. 2-2-2 is not good. All right. Let's see here. Kurt Casilli. One hit, seven at bats. 1-1-1 is going to be a strikeout.
One out.
See you later. Brad Bratch has come in. Logan Forsythe, three hits, two at bats, through 38, struck out.
Two outs, bases empty.
And Logan Morrison, one home run, three hits so far in the season. He's got a three, strike out.
They go down quietly, nothing doing this half inning. Bottom of the seventh.
All right, seventh inning stretch, take me out to the ball game. All right, Matt Wieters, one home run, five hits, two RBIs, a couple strikeouts on the season. He struck out. It was really low
one
numbers
out,
are
empty.
Bad.
They're making the call to the bullpen.
All right, so they're going to bring in a lefty to face Pedro Alvarez. Hot hitting Alvarez, 286. Come on, you can do it, Alvarez. 36. That's a strikeout.
Two outs, bases empty. They're making the call to the bullpen.
Bring in a righty to face J.J. Hardy. So column three, five, or six. Okay. Come on, J.J. Two hits. You need to get on the snide here. That's not going to do it.
It's a 1-2-3 inning. Top of the eighth.
All right, who do we got coming up? We got a righty, a lefty, righty, lefty. Yeah, Tampa Bay, it goes right, left, right, left, right, left, all the way down. So we're going to be bringing in... Although Bratch is still doing okay. Ball hit to J.J. Hardy. Possible error. No error. Okay.
One out. Base is empty.
Yeah, he's got one more batter. I think that's what this number represents. So it's a lefty. If we're going to pull him, since this will be his last batter anyways, the manager, Buck Showalter, is going to take him out. All right? Against the lefty. We're going to bring in... We're going to bring in Darren O'Day. He looks like our eighth inning man, it looks like. I think that's what that represents. All right, and even though he's a righty, he did come and pitch in the game. So, 12. Ball hit to Machado. Possible error. No, Machado. No error on Machado. They're trying. The computer's trying to make this error out. All right, Pierce. He played lots of positions here. That's a five. That should be a strikeout. It is. All right, 2-1, bottom of eight.
This half inning. Bottom of the eighth.
Another close nail biter here. We got Shope, Kim, and back to Rickard here. If any of them get on, Machado will be back up. Alrighty. Well, Shope. Starting off with the base hit would be beautiful. Leaping catch by the shortstop.
One out, base is empty.
All right, Hung So Kim, who had a single. It's going to be a fly out to short.
Two outs, base is empty.
Joey Rickard still hitless in 17 at-bats. He's on the training block if you know anybody that's looking for somebody.
It's a 1-2-3 inning. Top of the ninth.
Rickard, he only has a 2 defense, which is not good. His error rating is okay, but... All right, looks like we're going to have to bring in the closer here. Let's see, who is the saves? Britain. All right, Britain. In Britain, we trust. Brad Miller coming in, 4 hits.
The manager calls for a pinch hitter.
Help, they don't like the lefty matchup. So you're going to bring in Brandon Geyer's hitless so far. 12, pop up to first. That's going to be a P3.
One out, base is empty.
Davis makes the catch. Good job, good job. Steven Souza, who has a single, and a strikeout. 18, that's going to be a ball hit to J.J. Hardy. That's going to be a 6-3 play.
Two outs, base is empty.
Kevin Kiermaier, 6 hits on the season. He's popped up to second. He's hit a ground ball 6-4 and has struck out.
The manager calls for a pinch hitter.
Well, all that, and now they pull him out for Beckham, who's had 1 hit, which happened to be a home run, which was a single home run. He also walked. Tim Beckham. 32 is going to be up. Up and caught by Rickard. You can put this one in the books, folks. That's a Baltimore victory. Brad Bratz with the win. Jake Odorizzi with the loss. Britton with his second save of the season. Chris Davis with that big 2-run home run in the 6th inning. Puts Baltimore ahead 2-1 to stay. Excellent. We're going to just auto-play these games out because we went way over. Let's see what the final scores were. Texas beat Anaheim 5-3. Baltimore beat Tampa Bay 2-1. Minnesota beat Kansas City 5-4. Seattle shut out Oakland. Boston shut out Toronto. The Cubs doubled up Arizona. St. Louis beat Atlanta 3-1. Pittsburgh 6, Cincinnati 1. Colorado edged San Diego. Houston beats Milwaukee 5-4. Same score as the Mets take Philadelphia. San Francisco loses to the Dodgers 2-0. And Miami 3, Washington 2. So, updated scoreboard here. Tampa Bay is now 4-2 in the season. Baltimore is 3-2. Just a half game back. Let's see who Tampa Bay is. Let's check out their schedule. So they got to play Cleveland and the White Sox. We got to play Boston and who do we play? Texas afterwards, who's 5-2, leading their division by a game over Oakland, who's got a respectable 4-3. 3, 4, 5. We only played 5 games. These guys have played 7 games over here. In the National League, Miami is undefeated this season, 4-0. leading their division by 2 games. Pittsburgh's winning their division by a game over the Cubs, Milwaukee, and St. Louis. This division is red hot except for Cincinnati. And then in the National League West, Arizona and the Dodgers both at 5-2. So good start to the season. We've now above 500 for the first time ever this season. Let's see if we can keep it going as we take on the dreaded Boston Red Sox. 3-game series at Fenway Park. See you guys in the next episode. Thanks for watching.